Hi.
My name is Ciro Donalek, and this is the first of three modules about classification. Today, I'll recap the basic concepts in supervised learning, and then I'll show how to measure the accuracy of a classifier and how to evaluate it. In the next classes, we'll see some models more in details. Classification, as we have already said, is one of the most popular data mining tasks. In a classification problem, we want to divide our samples in classes and assign each new object to a given class. Because the class label of each training example is provided, the learning process is said to be supervised. And as we have seen in the introduction to machine learning, we talk about supervised learning when, for some examples, the correct results are known and are given in input to the model during the learning process. Ideally, the classifier will be then able to generalize. That means it will be able to determine the correct results also for unseen instances. We have also talked about the datasets needed to correctly train a classifier. We have seen that to achieve better results and be able to generalize, we need to split our dataset in three independent ones: training, validation, and test sets. Training and validation are then used during the learning phase, while the test set is used to assess the results of a fully trained classifier and provide an unbiased estimate of the generalization error. We have also seen the different cross-validation techniques that we can use to avoid overfitting. And as a quick recap, overfitting occurs when a model is not be able to generalize and start to memorize the training data rather than learning the general trend, like in the figure on the right. Basically, in an overfitting situation, we have a relatively small error on the training set, but a much larger error when new data is presented to the network. Now, let's see how the classification works. We can describe it as a two-step process. First, we build the model, and then we use it. So, the first step is the learning process, in which we wish to learn a function that divides clearly the data in classes. Typically, this mapping is represented in form of classification rules, decision trees, or mathematical formulas. In the second step, we want to be able to use the model to do the actual classification on real data. And first, we need to assess its accuracy using an independent test set. Once we are satisfied with the accuracy reached, we can save the classifier and deploy it on new data, whose labels are not known. And the outputs of a classifier can be crispy or probabilistic. In a crispy classification, the output is just the label, so black and white, zero or one, while in a probabilistic classification, for each sample, the classifier returns its probabilities to belong to each class. Probabilistic classification is very useful when we need a high accuracy to make a decision. So we can, for example, take action only on data that have a probability to belong to a given class greater than 90% and decide to be undecided on the other cases. To assign objects to classes in probabilistic classification, we can apply some rules. For example, the winner-take-all rule assigns objects to the class with the highest probability. Or we can introduce threshold and decide to assign objects to the class with the highest probability, but only if that probability is greater than a threshold, say 40%. Now, let's see in more details how to evaluate a classifier. As we have seen, accuracy is related to the ability of make correct prediction. Speed, in this case, refers to the computational cost in both building the model, so in the training time, or doing the actual classification of new data, and that's the classification time. Robustness is the ability of the classifier to make correct prediction, also in presence of noisy or missing values. Scalability, instead, is the ability to handle large amounts of data. Now, let's briefly see some pre-processing steps that may be applied to improve accuracy, efficiency, and scalability of the classifiers. For example, data cleaning. Data cleaning refers to the task of removing noise, for example, applying smoothing techniques, or we can choose how to treat missing values. For example, we may decide to replace a missing values with the most probable value. And actually, some classification models have already some sort of mechanism for handling noisy and missing data, but this step will still help in achieving better results. Then we can do a relevance analysis and search, for example, for redundant or irrelevant attributes that can slow down the process, but also lead to worse results because they can be misleading. So in this type of analysis, correlation analysis can be used to identify features that are statistically related. Basically, we want to see if two variables change together in a consistent manner. For example, a strong correlation between two attributes may suggest that one of the two can be eliminated without losing in accuracy. Now, plots on the right show some examples where A and B are perfect correlations. C and F, you can tell that are not correlated at all. D and D are still linearly correlated, even though not perfectly. And G is instead an example of a nonlinear correlation. Now, let's talk more in details about accuracy measures. As we have already said, accuracy is better estimated on an independent test set in order to avoid over-optimistic estimates due to overfitting. Now, we can start defining the classification rate as the overall percentage of objects correctly classified. And the misclassification rate, or loss, is simply 1 minus the classification rate. Now, the confusion matrix is really helpful in visualizing how good is the classification, even class by class. By definition, in the confusion matrix, the network prediction Y are compared with the target T. Then the row represent the true classes, and the columns the predicted classes. In this example, we can easily see that in the first confusion matrix, 34 galaxies have been incorrectly classified as stars. Now, let's see the confusion matrices in more details. And this figure shows actually 4 confusion matrices for training, testing, validation, and all the data. In this case, we can also tell that the network outputs are very accurate, as you can see by the high numbers of correct responses in the green squares, and the low numbers of incorrect responses in the red squares. Now, the lower right blue squares show the overall accuracy. And usually, the classification rate on the training set is much higher than one of the test set, of course, because we are using that data in the learning process. But remember that it's the classification rate on the test set that gives you an idea of the generalization power of the classifier you are building. Now, other two important measures related are completeness and contamination. Completeness can be defined as the percentage of objects of a given class correctly classified as such. On the other hand, contamination for a given class is the percentage of objects of other classes incorrectly classified as belonging to that class, so they will contaminate that class. And precision can be seen as a measure, precision defined as 1 minus the contamination, can be seen as a measure of the quality of your classification, while completeness is more a measure of quantity. In simple terms, high precision means that An algorithm basically returns substantially more relevant results than irrelevant, while high completeness means that an algorithm retrieved most of the relevant results. Confusion matrix can be also generalized for M classes. And in general, given M classes, a confusion matrix is a M by M table as shown in this example. And for a classifier, to have a good accuracy, most of the samples would be represented along the diagonal, and the entries in the other cells should be close to zero. Now, in this example, that's a supernova subtypes classification, we can see that we are able to classify very well supernova type 1a with a good accuracy, but most of the supernova type 1b are confused with 1a. So in this case, the confusion matrix can also help understand which classes are overlapping and may need further analysis. Now, let's consider just a two-class problem. For example, given some features, we want to be able to tell if a patient has or not cancer. Classes in this case are negative and positive. True negative and true positive are the patients correctly classifying as having or not having cancer. False positive are the patients classified as cancerous while they are not. False negative, the opposite. Now, we have defined the accuracy rate as the percentage of objects correctly classified. Now, let's ask a question. In this case, an accuracy rate of 90% is satisfying? Actually, we cannot tell more. This is a clear case where just the accuracy rate is not sufficient, because suppose only 3-4% of training set is labeled as cancer. A classifier that classifies all the elements as not cancer would have 96% classification rate. And this is a common problem, especially when dealing with unbalanced data sets. Besides, in this case, the cost associated with false negative will be far greater than the cost associated with false positive, because incorrectly classifying a cancerous patient as not cancerous will be far more costly than the opposite, because the first can lead to the patient death, the latter just to a lawsuit. But luckily, we can use other measures to make better decisions and hopefully save the patient life, like sensitivity, specificity, and precision. Sensitivity is the proportion of positive samples correctly identified. Basically, it's the completeness of the positive class. On the other hand, specificity is the proportion of negative samples correctly identified. And in this case, precision is the percentage of samples labeled as cancer that are actually cancer. Basically, it's the ratio between the true positive and the sum of the true positive plus the false positives. Now, classification also poses many challenges. We will need probably to deal with multi-parametric large datasets. Data can be sparse and heterogeneous. We may want to be able to perform a reliable classification in real time with a high completeness and a low contamination, and we may also need to include external knowledge in our models. So, in the next videos, we'll see more in details some classification models, such as neural networks and support vector machines, and also how to combine different types of classifiers in order to achieve better results.